Oh Lord.
What up?
What's up?
Brother Art the Hell.
Good morning, good morning.
There's a couple of new guys in here, but most of these guys know who you are.
Amen. Just a little feedback.
You getting feedback?
Yeah. Echoing.
What's not even on?
Okay.
Let
me turn down on my end too. All right, can y'all hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Good morning.
All right. This morning, I wanted to talk about the love of God a little bit, but more so, I want to talk about the title of my message.
Uh-oh.
Right.
Okay.
Got some feedback.
I don't know what happened.
Oh.
I'm going to turn my video off.
Okay.
Someday we're going to pick. You know what we did the other day? We did a Zoom thing, and it was pretty good. It was.
We're just talking
about.
Yeah,
I should have already signed up for one myself. I told Chris I'm going to sign up for it. You guys don't have to pay.
It's like $12 a month.
Okay, see if you could. There he is. Go ahead.
You guys can hear me all right?
Yeah.
Amen. All right, good morning. This morning, I just want to talk about knowing God. You know, the title of this message is To Love Him is to Know Him. You know, and that simply means, you know, if you want to love God, then you got to know who He is first. And I don't mean the entity of God. You know, we sing songs a lot of times, and we've all been guilty of this, and we sing songs and we view God as an entity. And as that song was just saying, He is alive. He's alive inside of us. And we have to abide in that place where we get to know Him properly. And we can't say that we love Him until we really get to know Him. So let's start off in 1 John 4:16. 1 John 4:16, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God and God in him. God is love, and in order to know him properly, we must become love ourselves. We must make it our daily mission to become this love. This is unconditional love. It's not based on conditions of what God can do for us or what we can receive for him, but it's literally believing in everything that he stands for, standing for everything that he stands for, you know, and I think that's very important, you know, that you know, we have to really believe in the alive God, the God that's alive inside of us, not the entity of, oh, this big God that's somewhere far away. No, I'm talking about learning to see him face to face. You know, David, King David, you know, he made a lot of mistakes in his ministry or in his walk with God. But, you know, what was interesting about him is that he had such a reverence for God. He had such a intimacy with God that no matter the mistakes he made, and I'm not co-signing those mistakes or nothing like that. I'm just saying that he had a face-to-face relationship with God. So when he messed up, you know, it was easy for him because he knew who God was. He knew who God was intimately. It was easy for him to repent and get right back in right standing with God. And here's the problem with not knowing him face to face is we'll go out here and we'll make a mistake and then we'll run from God like Adam did in the garden. You know, we'll run from him thinking that we can hide from him because we don't know him intimately. We don't know that, you know what, he doesn't care about the mistakes we make, you know. So that's the beauty of the relationship David had, but it's also sometimes can be the crutch for us as Christians, is that, you know, we make a mistake and we run from God because we've been taught he's going to be mad at us, or we've been taught that he's keeping count of all of our wrongdoings and you've heard it all and so forth and so forth. But when you really get to know who God is intimately, then you can make a mistake and repent and get right back in right standing with God, and you never lose your righteousness in your heart, you know, or in your mind. We know the Bible says that we can never lose our righteousness once we've come into the kingdom of God. But if you live from a mentality that you only know God as this entity far away, that, you know, that will create this place inside of you that you will repent all the time instead of living in righteousness, you know. So I want to really kind of expound on this today, that we have to understand this unconditional love he has for us. There's no conditions. There's nothing we have to do. We can't earn it. You know, he, before the foundation of the world, he created us, you know. And this is very interesting statistic, and I'm not going to do the numbers, but you got to know that to be born into this world, I mean, the statistics, if you looked up the numbers, it would be astounding to know what probability you have to even be born into this world. You know, Dan Moeller said it like this, and I don't want to get too far into this, but he said there was 50 million swimmers swimming to that egg. He said, and you were taking a backstroke, and what did you do? You were destined before the foundation of the world to be born into this world. So just being born into this world is really amazing, and our mind sometimes can't wrap around the fact that we weren't a mistake to be born into this world. Yeah, I know there's a lot of times that people are born into sin, but we all had a sin nature when we was born. You know, it wasn't until we came to know God and fellowship with Jesus and accepted him as our Savior that we were born again on the inside. But just being born the first time into this world is really a miracle if you really study this out, you know. And I truly believe that we can't truly love anyone properly until we get to know him. You know, I can meet a brother and sister in Christ and tell them I love them because that's what I'm called to do as a Christian. But to really love them properly, I have to get to know them personally. I have to spend time with that person. You know, and that doesn't change when it comes to God. If we want to know the living, true God that's alive inside of us, then we have to truly, truly spend time with him intimately. And I think, you know, this is where I think it's very important, you know, praying in the Holy Spirit. You know, the Bible says when I speak in an unknown tongue, I'm speaking only unto God. You know, that's a language between me and God only. That's a place of intimacy that my mind doesn't get in the way. All the distractions of life doesn't get in the way, you know. And I think that's something I'm finding out, and I've known this for years, but the deeper and deeper I dig into this prayer language, the deeper and deeper I dig into just spending this time with God in fellowship, you know, just communicating with God in this language, man, there's just things began to come together in my life like a puzzle. You know, it's like going out on my own, starting a business. You know, Josh can tell you this, you know, it sometimes can be challenging, you know, because you really don't know where the next job is coming from. But when you spend this intimate time with God and he begins to, the Holy Spirit is praying God's perfect will for your life, then you're beginning to get these deposits down inside of you of this wisdom, and it's inside you in your spirit, and it begins to bubble up into your mind. So you can just be riding about throughout the day, and all of a sudden you're getting these places of wisdom that you're like, where'd that come from? Well, it would come from your spirit. You know, the Holy Spirit lives inside your born-again spirit, and when you allow him to pray God's perfect will for your life, this begins to come up and reach our mind, you know, and that's the place I think is very important. You know, when it comes to God, what I found talking to people is that most people base their love for him on what someone else has taught them about him. You know, and that's very dangerous. Or they base their love for God based on the level of experience they've had with him. But, you know, if you've only taken someone else's word for who God is, then your level of experience with him is going to be completely different than someone who spent a lot of time with God. You know, and that's just a dangerous place. We can't get to know others based off what someone else has said about them. We also can't get to know others based on one experience we have with them. You know, I was talking to a brother yesterday who called me, and he lost his father, but his father was up in age and he had been sick. And, you know, I just simply told him, I said, you know, at the end of the day, we can't change the fact that God is always good. You know, the unfortunate situation is we live in a world that's affected by sin. We live in a fallen world, and sin causes diseases and sickness and all these other things. And so when I was ministering to him, I just said, you know, we can't base the fact that this happened to your father and take away from the fact. And I told him, I said, God is still good. It doesn't change that at all. You know, we can't change God is love and God is good based on an experience, you know, because there's a lot of other things that go into this situation. And so I was just ministering that to him, and you know, it was more from a place of love to him and reminding him that, you know, we can't let circumstances dictate how we view God. And I think that's a dangerous place as well, you know. And I'm truly convinced that God can only be good. You know, I think that that's the purpose of these ministries. As you guys come in here, you hear Pastor Chris and everyone that comes in here and speaks, everybody's in the same line that God can only be good. You know, it's interesting when I speak to people, I can know within 30 seconds whether or not they got to know God intimately or if they just believe in this entity of God, you know, because it's funny what comes out of their mouth. You know, immediately when you hear someone speak, then you know whether or not they truly believe God is good. You know, those yeah buts, you hear that all the time. You know, but no condemnation in Christ. You know, these people were taught incorrectly. It's not their fault. It's not holding them back from spending eternal relationship with God. But it does, honestly, it does prevent you from walking in the fullness of everything God has for you. It also prevents you from really getting to know God face to face. You know, and I think that's the part I want to discuss this morning, that we got to get to know God face to face. And let's go to Philippians 3, 8 through 10. And before I read this, I just want to kind of give you this about Paul. This is the Apostle Paul writing this. And what's interesting about Paul is he didn't even walk with Jesus. You know, he didn't even get to walk with Jesus while Jesus was on the earth. But when you read, you know, he wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. When you read what he wrote about Jesus, you would think that he walked with him every single day. You know, and it's amazing when I read Paul versus the other apostles that walk with Jesus, and it's very, very much in line with each other. But what's more interesting is that, you know, how much Paul talks about really knowing Jesus. You know, and I'm truly convinced the Bible says that, you know, the Apostle Paul went 14 years without being with the apostles or being around the church, and I believe in those 14 years that he spent a lot of time just praying in the spirit and talking to God. And fellowshipping with the Holy Spirit, because he was kind of alone out in the desert, and it was just him and the Holy Spirit every day with no distractions. You know, a lot of us would be figuring out how are we going to survive with nobody to talk to, but he just sit and talk to God all day long, and now we have 2/3 of the New Testament because of that. And you know, it's interesting, in 1 Corinthians he says, I thank God I speak in tongues more than you all. That sounded like a very almost haughty statement, but I think what he was saying is, I can tell you that I do it a lot, and that's what Paul was saying. It doesn't matter how long you do it. I'm just telling you that what I got, what I wrote down, is what I got from praying that in that prayer language, because it just basically says that you're only speaking to God. So let's go to Philippians 3:8-10. It says, indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes from the faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings and become like him in his death. You know, I want to clarify this. You know, he said I counted all as loss. Everything I've done, I counted all as loss just to know who God is. You know, having a ministry calling and walking in it is great. Going out and feeding the poor is great. Going out and doing outreach is great. Going out and doing conferences is great. But none of these can take the place of knowing God face to face. You know, our intimacy with God has to be first. You know, I believe sometimes as ministers, they get out here and they make it all about the ministry and everything that they're supposed to do, that they lose sight of that face-to-face relationship with Jesus. And people like that tend to get burned out, and they tend to give up, or they tend to begin to walk away from what God has called them into, not in a place of stepping down, but almost in a place of losing that anointing on their life. You know, that anointing is called, anointing means to smear. The only way you can be smeared is to be face to face with someone all the time. And so I just really want to encourage everybody in here. We all have a calling on our life. Everyone was called to go out and preach the gospel, to go out and lay hands on the sick. You know, that's our commission. Everyone in here, just because you don't do it behind the pulpit doesn't mean it's not your calling. But just because that's what God's called us to do, I think that we have to really, really, really be close attention to the fact that we got to get to know him intimately face to face. Because when we get to know him intimately face to face, then when we get around someone, he'll begin to speak through us, because we believe in that alive person inside of us instead of that entity that seems so far away. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Amen. All right. Let's go to Proverbs 8:17. Proverbs 8:17. And this is from the English Standard Version. It says, I love those who love me, and those who seek me diligently find me. Like I was saying earlier, God is not a distant deity that's real far off that we cannot know. God is very personal. He desires to have an intimate relationship with all of us. He's not the one to rule and reign without ever being close to you as a father first. Sometimes we view him as someone who, like I said, he's keeping account of our wrongdoings, or he's sitting up there going, oh, you missed it again. No, first and foremost, he's a father, you know. And it's hard sometimes, because a lot of us didn't have natural fathers that learned or that walked in the love of God. And so we didn't really get a good example of what a father's like. But what a true father is like is, it doesn't matter what you do right or what you do wrong or what you do at all, that father still comes and looks at you every day in your face and tells you how much he loves you. It's never an account of what you did for him today. It's never an account on how well you did at school or how well you did at work. It's none of those things. The true father comes and he loves you face to face every day, no matter what you've done. And so first and foremost, I think that we have to view him as our Father before we get into the place of trying to view him as anything else, you know. And he desires a close, intimate relationship with all of his children. And scripture is very clear that when we seek to know him, we will find him. He says, draw near to me and I will draw near to you, you know. And we have to, that has to be our heart's desire. It has to be our desire to get to know him. He always has a desire to get to know us. He always has a desire to show himself to us, but he's also a perfect gentleman. He's not going to force himself on you. And, you know, the Bible talks a lot about the mysteries of God. You know, I think it's very, very, very important to understand that, you know, God has concealed this word for us as our protection. And what I mean by that is when we're willing to get intimate with him and dig face to face with him, then he'll begin to reveal these mysteries to us. But when he reveals these mysteries to us, because we have that intimate relationship with him, we'll begin to understand these mysteries. You know, Jesus spoke in parables because he knew they weren't going to understand him anyway. It wasn't going to make sense to them. He knew it was going to cause more confusion if he went out and just told them straight up what he was trying to say to them, because they didn't have, at that moment he was speaking to them, they didn't have the Holy Spirit living inside of them. They wouldn't have understood it anyway. But how much more can we obtain the fact that we have the Holy Spirit living inside of us? We have infinite wisdom living in us. We have, you know, all wisdom. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives inside of us. So we have the capability and the ability to really, really just pour things in and really get to know God in such a deep, deep level. And he really wants to reveal himself to you. That's his heart's desire, is to reveal everything about himself to you. And I just want to make that very clear this morning. You know, and let me spend a second talking about how, you know, God speaks. We know as sons of God that God's desire is to speak to us face to face. But there is a season in life when you have young believers, and I truly believe this, and I'm going to give you guys a little story real quick. But first, before I do that, I'm going to read Romans 1:20. It says, for since the creation of this world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. You know, there's a season in your life where you can be still getting to know God, where he can speak to you through creation, you know. But that's not his ultimate goal. His ultimate goal is to speak to you as a son. His ultimate goal is to speak to you face to face. But like I said, no condemnation. There's times in your life where you need just to see something out here in creation to know that God is speaking to you. So I'm going to give you a good example of this. I took a walk with someone that's very dear to me, and we walked through this on this trail, and it was paved, but it had a bunch of trees on each side, and on the right side of the trees it had like a little creek going down it. So this creek was just flowing water, and it was very peaceful. It was very it was just a very beautiful place. So we're walking through there, and then they got a few of these little insets where you could walk down and get close to the water. So we're just walking down, and we're speaking, and you know, we're just talking about how beautiful it is and how peaceful it is. And we're just sitting down a couple of times on these little benches and just taking a moment to just chat. You know, I'm just loving on this person and really letting them, you know, see creation more than anything. You know, so as we take our walk, we're coming back. The sun's been out, but we're kind of in a shaded area. So then it begins to kind of sprinkle rain a little bit, but the sun's shining bright. So the rain is just kind of, like I told this person, it's more just cooling us off, you know. So, you know, the Bible says that God visited Adam in the cool of the day, you know. So I was just kind of giving this person that analogy, like God's just loving on us. He's just cooling us off. So as we come back, here's what's interesting. As we come back, we walk through this. When we come out the other side of this trail, we come into this clearing where it's like wide open. And there's a building over here being built with a lot of windows. Excuse me. So what's interesting is, as we walk into this clearing, we look over, we see this building, excuse me. We see this building with all these windows. And there's a rainbow above us. Sorry, guys, I went down low. Give me a second. So, sorry, anyway, we come out of this clearing and we look over and there's a rainbow in the sky. And this building that they're building has a bunch of windows that they have built on it. And I've never seen the end of a rainbow. Every time I've ever seen a rainbow in the sky, it's always been super far away. But this, I'm gonna send this picture to Chris later for y'all to see. But this rainbow was literally landing into the glass of this building. And we were about literally a football field away. And this person that I was with, it was like, oh my God, you see that? We're literally at the end of the rainbow. And I was like, wow, what are the chances of that? So then this person asked me, he said, what does a rainbow mean? I said, well, the rainbow first came whenever after the flood, after God sent the flood, the rainbow came as a promise, as a covenant between him and his people that he would never destroy the earth in that way again, you know. So it was more so like also what I began to tell this person was I also believe that it's a place where God could be speaking to us or speaking to you at this moment that you're at the end of your stormy season. Now you're walking into your sunny season or your rainbow season, you know, and this person just lit up. You can tell it encouraged them. You can tell it brought them so much faith. And this is just an example of how God can speak to you through his creation. That's not the primary way that he wants to speak to you. And I don't want to teach that as this is what you should be looking for. You know, because Jesus, you know, he rebuked the disciples for always seeking the sign. You know, but there is a season in your life. God knows where we are. If we're young in the faith, and he knows sometimes we need to see things to understand. But it's also not a sin to go out here and be looking for God in everything that you do. That when we are still, we are more sensitive to the things of God. And the more still I am, the more often I sit quietly before him, the more I get to know about God and the more I know God. You know, of course, we're never going to know everything about God, and that's okay. You know, but I was telling Pastor Chris this yesterday. I've been driving this dump truck, and it's been refreshing because I got all this time in this truck. And I don't take that lightly. I use it diligently. I got all this time in this truck, and I got my headphones charging at all times. I got them in my ears. I'm riding down the road. I'm listening to worship. I'm listening to teachings. I'm praying in the spirit the entire time. I'm really sitting still before, even though I'm driving and have to pay attention to the road, I'm still sitting still listening for God to speak to me. And I was telling Chris how refreshing it is to have that time. You know, we all have busy lives, and your job or whatever you do every day may not allow that time, you know. And so there's been seasons in my life when I didn't have that time, and I had to get up earlier in the morning and find that quiet time, or I had to do it late at night. You know, everybody has a different place where they're at. They have a different circumstance and situation. So you know, you got to fight, you got to contend and fight for that time with God. You got to fight for that intimacy with God, you know. But if you do that, if you fight for that and you really make it your life mission to be intimate with God, man, he's going to do so many great things inside your life. He's going to speak to you in ways you never understood or never believed could happen. He's going to reveal so many things about your life. There's people in this room right now that have so many great things that God wants to do through them. There's people in this room right now that, you know, there could be somebody in this room right now, and I'm not even joking, that has the cure for cancer down inside of them. But you got to be willing to go intimately and tap into that. You know, God has placed so many wise things down inside of people. And I remember Brother Howard teaching this before, and he made this statement. And he said, you know how much wisdom is in a graveyard where people who had the Holy Spirit inside of them could have had all these answers to the earth's problems, and they just died because they just not die. They didn't die because they refused to be intimate with God, but because they died and didn't tap into that intimacy with God, they just left behind or almost wasted so much wisdom down inside of them, you know. And no condemnation again. You know, the bottom line is, if we believe that Jesus is our Lord and Savior, and we're going to be in eternal relationship with God, that's all that matters. I want to clarify that. But I'm just saying that our lives will reflect a stillness before God. That should be our desire in every one of us. You know, being still before God positions us to know God more intimately, and that changes everything in our life. All right, let's go to, for the sake of time, let's go to 1 John 2:4. 1 John 2:4. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. You cannot claim to know God and then at the same time deny him with your daily actions. There is a place of obedience that we have to live by. You know, we have to live in such a way that our walk speaks Jesus loud and clear. You know, if we claim to know God and don't keep his commandments, he's saying that he's calling us a liar, you know. And that's kind of harsh, and you know, reading the scripture, I'm kind of like, wow, that's harsh. But it is the truth. You know, you can't sit around and say that you know God, but then you're not willing to walk like Jesus walked. You know, I'll give you guys another quick example. I like using examples of things that's happened because I just feel like that brings the word out sometimes. So there was a group of friends when my son played football in California. There was a group of friends that we met, and they were very good business people. They had a lot of money, and they just kind of took us in and really just treated us like family, you know. And through my time hanging out with them, what I found was one of them was an atheist, and one of them had believed in Scientology. But it's interesting. What was interesting is I never cared what they believed. I did for the sake of me praying for them, me wanting them to be saved, and that gave me an open door to be able to do that for them. But it was never about, you know, I couldn't hang out with them because they didn't love God the way I did, you know. And so when I was around them, I just remember always there were times where politics would come up, and I'd be like, nope, not speaking on that. And then we'd talk about certain things. I'm like, nope, not getting into that. And then I would just become love in front of them. I would just overshower them with the love of God, you know, because the Bible is very clear that people should know us by our love. So I just remember really being very loving toward them and just being very compassionate toward them. And it's interesting because we hadn't seen them in about a year or two. And the other day, out of the blue, I get a text, and he texts me out of the blue, and he's just like, you know, this world is crazy, blah, blah, blah. He's like, I'm scared, I'm this, I'm that. And then he just goes on to say, I really love you because you always showed so much love, and you never got in the middle of all the things that's going on in the world, and you didn't get in the middle of this, you didn't get in the middle of that. He said, and you just loved everybody around you, and you know, that really touched my heart, because I'm glad to know that I made that type of impact on them. And he said I know you are what you always said you were. He said, by the way that you treated us and the way that you acted around us, you know. And I don't always get it right. I'm not sitting up here tooting my own horn. You know, I miss it all the time too. But, you know, I've learned this, that two ways to keep the doors of heaven open in your life. You know, the Bible says that Jesus walked under an open heaven. And what God has been showing me is two things that keep the door open, the doors of heaven open over your life. One of them, of course, the top one is always going to be humility. You know, the Bible says God resists the proud and he gives grace to the humble. But humility will always keep the doors of heaven open over your life. If you get to a place where you walk in humility all the time toward others, toward God, toward everything that you do, you're so grateful and you live from a place of gratitude and thankfulness because of your humility, that keeps the doors of heaven open. And number two, what God shared with me is a lifestyle of repentance. I don't mean falling on my face every day and going, oh my God, I messed up again. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about simply when you go about and you miss it, you just simply say, Lord, I missed it. And if you took something out of another person, if you walked out of love, just simply look at the person and say, hey, my bad. I'm sorry. I missed it. I didn't mean to respond that way. You know, very simple. Those two things will keep the doors open. The doors of heaven open for you in your life. And God kind of gave me this as an example. You know, Lucifer was in heaven. He was the minister of music, and he got kicked out of heaven. Well, the number one reason he got kicked out of heaven is what he said, he was going to exalt himself above God. That was pride. That was no humility at all. And number two, he wouldn't repent. He just kept on saying this over and over and over until God had to kick him out of heaven. So that's just a little analogy for you, that those two things will keep the doors of heaven open in your life. You know, let's go to John 21:15-17. John 21:15-17. This is Jesus talking to Peter, and I love this story, but I really want to show you why I'm reading this. It says, when they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Peter said, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him this the third time. Do you love me? And Peter said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. So what we're getting to in this, when Jesus is asking him, do you love me? And he's saying, feed my sheep. What he means is we have to tend to and care for other people. You know, the Bible's very clear. It says, how can you say that you love God, but you don't love your brother? You don't love your sister? You know, that's a big part of knowing who God is learning to love other people's like learning to love other people like God loves them. You know, that's something that's very important. And Jesus said this three times. So when you see Jesus write down anything and speak it three times, it must mean that there's a lot of weight that goes with this, you know. And I think it's interesting that he challenged Peter in this, you know, hey, feed my sheep. Basically, it's just telling us to go out here and really make sure that we're taking care of our brothers and sisters in Christ, that we're trying to raise up the weakest link. We're trying to love on people at their worst moment of their day, trying to meet a need of someone that needs something at that moment. It could be spiritual, it could be physical, it could be financial. You know, whatever it is, we got to be willing to say, hey, I love you. Doesn't matter what you say or do, I still love you, you know. And that's the thing, you're gonna deal with people sometimes that you feel like don't deserve your love, but we didn't deserve God's love, and he still gave it to us freely, you know. So we have to be willing to give that same love away that God gave to us. Amen. All right, let's close with this right here. Psalm 37:4, it says, delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. The word delight means to bend yourself toward or be inclined toward, to take pleasure in. When we bend our hearts toward God and take pleasure into knowing God, then our desires meet his desires, then his desire for us fulfills the desire of our heart. I made that wordy on purpose, but I'm going to read it to you again. The word delight means to bend toward or to be inclined toward or to take pleasure in. When we bend our hearts toward God and take pleasure into knowing God, then our desires meet God's desires, and then God's desire for us fulfills the desires of our heart. And ultimately, it's just saying that when we make it our life mission to be intimate and see God's face to face, and we delight ourselves in diving into this word, when we delight ourselves in prayer with God, we delight ourselves in worship, when we make it our life mission to be in God's face as much as possible, and we make it all about him, then he begins to make it all about us. You know, very simple, that's how relationships work. The more you put into a relationship, the more you'll get out of it. The more distance you create in a relationship, the worse off that relationship's gonna be. And that's where the open door of the enemy comes in. And I'll use this in a natural example in just natural relationships. If you have a relationship with someone, you're not communicating and you're not spending time with that person, you give the devil an open door to begin to sow lies and all this. Well, the same is true in our relationship with God. The enemy can never sow lies about you to God. God knows better. But the enemy can sow lies to you about God when things aren't working out, or when you haven't had this relationship with God, or you believe something about God that's not true, or you took someone else's word for who God is or a circumstance, then the enemy can begin to use all these little things to come in your life and say, see, look, God doesn't love you. He's not doing this. He's not doing that. And all that's really happened is there's just a gap. There's just the FaceTime call dropped and you need to call him back. I use that for our analogy this morning. All right. So today, ask yourself these questions. How well do you know God? And this is always good for someone to challenge you. It's always good for you to be challenged, you know, not in a condescending way, but in a loving way of wanting to motivate you. So today, ask yourself, this is inclination. Go inside yourself today and find out, ask yourself these questions. How well do I know God? How much time do I spend with him to get to know him more? You know, those two things, ask yourself that. You know, none of us can ever know the fullness of God to the full. You know, none of us have enough time in a 24-hour period to get to that place. But I can tell you this, the more that you decide to sacrifice time and sacrifice, you know, things in your life, busy seasons of your life, and you really take time to get to know God, like I said, no condemnation. It could start off at 5 minutes. It can lead to 15. It can be 2 hours. You know, whatever that season is for you, when you really take that time to get to know him, then he's going to really begin to show you who he is in your life. And when he begins to show you who he is in your life, you're going to begin to see a different type of God or a different person of God than you've ever seen. He becomes alive inside of you instead of this entity that's really far away. So let me pray with you guys, because I know we all got to go to work. Father, we love you. We thank you for everything that you do in our lives, Father. We just thank you that you're the Holy Spirit behind inside of us, Father, so that we can get to know you intimately. We can fellowship with your wisdom. We can sit in your presence every day, Father, and get things deposited down inside of us, Father, that really are for future seasons or for future moments in our life, Father. So I just thank you that as we spend time intimately with you, Father, that you begin to really give us the wisdom and revelation and speak the mysteries of God to us, so that we may be good for the people out here that are hurting and seeking you, Father. We may have a good word for them. We may have a place for them that they will get to know you, Father. We love you. I thank you for Able Ministries. I thank you for everyone at the sound of my voice. I just thank you as we all go out here today. May we be blessed. May we have great encounters with you and with other people. And may we just walk in this fullness of joy that the Bible has promised. We love you. We give you all the praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, buddy.
Love you guys.
Thank you.
Love you.
Thank you. Love you guys.